Mesos Con Asia, great to see a good crowd. It's the first ever Mesos Con in Asia, as you guys know. So it's awesome that there's a huge turnout. I'm hoping it's going to be big in the next few years. Or as Trump would say, it's going to be huge. So let's hope so. So a little bit about us. Myself, I'm Vinod Kone, and this is GU. Both of us have been long-time Mesos committers, as you can see. And coincidentally, we also have very similar trajectory in our professional life. We did PhDs, then went to Twitter, and then came to Mesosphere. So I wanted to start this talk off with the history of how we did containers up to this point in Mesos. As you guys probably know, since we're at MesosCon, Mesos has been around for a while. And we had some form of support for containers for a very long time. In fact, as far back as 0.10, we had rudimentary C group support for CPU and memory. We were able to isolate tasks and executors. And then we added pluggable isolation, which was a pretty big deal in the Mesos architecture, so that you can add your own organization-specific isolation techniques. And then we added support to Docker containers when Docker became a big thing in the DevOps community. First, we delegated most of the stuff to Docker daemon, and then we added support to run Docker images without even Docker daemon. And continuing that with that innovation, what we're talking about today is a new type of containerization that we are doing in Mesos. It's called nested containers. And most of you guys probably know it from Kubernetes as a pod. Always just a lot more generic than that, and we'll go into details of that. So before going too deep, I want to like kind of take a step back and kind of set the context of how things work in Mesos. So if you're familiar with the Mesos architecture, a typical Mesos cluster looks like this. You have a bunch of masters, typically 3 to 5, and then most of the rest of your cluster run these processes called agents, Mesos agents in your cluster. And the agents connect to the master, and master gives offers to these components called schedulers. And schedulers are these components that schedule some work on the nodes. Whether it's a thread, whether it's a process, whether it's a container, it's up to the scheduler. So what happens when a scheduler tries to schedule some work onto a node? So can let's zoom into the agent node to see what are the components that run or what are the primitives we have here. So Mesos always had these primitives of executors and tasks. So the way a scheduler schedules work is it sends this thing called a task, which is typically associated with an executor. And the idea with the executor is that executor runs the task as it sees fit. And it's a contact between the executor and the scheduler and how to run a task. And the executor was always able to run multiple tasks. And an agent, of course, could run multiple executors. But the key thing to note here is that executors typically run 1:1 with respect to containers. So each executor and all of its tasks were running inside one single container. So what's the issue with it, or what are the limitations in this kind of model? The first limitation is that it's kind of hard to manage a group of tasks as one single unit. So even though you could send multiple tasks to the executor, it's not very easy to give like all or nothing semantics to you. And the other limitation is that since executor and container are 1:1, you could only have one image for the whole executor and the task group. So if you wanted to have different tasks belonging to different, like Docker containers, for example, that's not possible to do. And also because all the tasks are running within the same container, they all share the same C group, which meant that you could not do isolation between the tasks within an executor. If you wanted isolation between the tasks, you had to run single task executors, and that's why you had to do isolation. And these kind of limitations, or something that we are beginning to see that it's not helping some of the use cases that we wanted to solve. So we wanted to come up with a new primitive that doesn't have these limitations or that can address these limitations. And this new primitive is a Mesos pod, if you will. So the idea is very simple. We wanted to have a primitive that lets us manage, like co-schedule and co-manage a set of a group of containers as a single atomic unit. And then we wanted these containers or tasks to be able to share some resources, like network or some volume, so that it's easy to like coordinate work with, between them. But at the same time, we want them to not share some sort of resources like their images, for example. We probably want some tasks to use different image than their tasks in the same executor. And more importantly, and this is where this is more generic than a Kubernetes pod, is that we want this group of containers to be dynamically updatable. So either it's growing and shrinking the pod or adding containers to the pod, we wanted to be able to do this stuff in a Mesos pod. And also we wanted to do hierarchical isolation, which means it's not just two levels like a Kubernetes pod, where there is a pod and all the containers at one level, but we wanted to do arbitrary levels of nesting. And so what do we get? Like, what are the use cases that we can actually solve by having this kind of primitive? So let's look at a few use cases that are really important in like today's world. The first use case is a sidecar pattern that you might have seen in microservices architecture. And the idea here is simple. You have a main container, let's say Memcached, and you want a sidecar container which can extend the functionality of the main container. Right? So for example, you could have a log saver container that's getting logs from Memcached and trying to shuffle it to some remote location. The nice thing is that this log saver container could be reused for lots of different main applications, whether it's Memcache or Redis or your web app or whatever. And they might be managed by different teams. And that's a great thing about this pattern of using sidecars. And the other use case that we wanted to address was this notion of a transient container. This is for the use case where you do not know upfront all the containers that you want to launch in your pod. So you probably want to launch the backup container for your Cassandra sometime late on a cron schedule, or maybe it's user-defined, like user clicks a button and you want to go into a backup. But you still want the backup to be in some of the same namespaces as the Cassandra container so that it's easy to communicate and get data out, right? And the last use case that we wanted to also address is running something like Kubernetes and making it really easy to run in Mesos, Kubernetes or Jenkins. So for a Kubelet to run as a Mesos task, since Kubelet runs its pods in a level that's below it in terms of C groups, for this to really work nicely in a Mesos ecosystem, you want to have at least three levels of nesting. So we wanted to be able to also solve this use case. So what are the primitives that we came up with? So there are two essential primitives that we have designed for 1.1. These are called task groups and nested containers. So I'm going to briefly talk about task group and then I'll let G talk about nested containerization in detail. So the first primitive that we introduced is called task group, and this is simply a collection of tasks. And the main idea here is that this task group is atomically delivered to the executor. At any point in its lifecycle, if one of the tasks gets killed for whatever reason, the whole task group gets shut down. And for this, we added a new offer operation called launch group, much like we had launch before to launch a task, now we have a launch group. And similar thing on the executor side, we have a launch group event that executors can use to get this group of tasks and run them as containers. So next up, I'll give it to G to talk about nested containers.
大家好，我就用中文讲了。然后另外右边都讲到我们加了两个 primitive，然后一个是 task group，一个是 nested container。然后我着重讲一下 nested container 这个 primitive。然后其实边都也讲到了，其实主要的一些特性就是说我们这个 primitive 是支持任意 level of nesting。然后我们可以 reuse 所有的那些 现有的那些 isolator。 然后更重要的是，我们可以支持动态的创建 nested container， 而不是说静态的让用户在启动 pod 之前指定你有多少个 container。然后其实我们就是加了一个 agent 的 API， 就是说在 agent 上面有一个 API， 然后可以让你动态的去启动 等待和销毁一个 nested container。然后看一个例子吧，就比如说 当你有个 container 已经人在那边，然后 executor 已经人在那边，然后当 executor 需要创建一个nested container 的时候，它会先call 到 agent 上面， agent 有个 API 可以说让你 launch 一个 nested container， 然后agent 会帮你创建一个 nested container， 然后在你那个 top level nested container 下面。然后但是还有个问题就是说你创建了这个 nested container， 你需要等待这个 nested container 结束，你要知道那个 nested container 是否结束，就是说退出正常，所以你需要调用另外一个 API 叫那个 wait， 然后 wait 可以等待那个 nested container 结束，然后如果结束的话它会返回那个 nested container 最后的退出的状态值，所以你可以那个 executor 可以决定是否重启这个 container， 或者说是把整个 pod 杀掉，就是executor 可以做决定的一件事情。然后最后就是说，当你有一个container 在这边，有时候你比如说你的那个主要那个 container 结束了以后，你想把你另外一个 container 杀掉，所以你可以做这件事情，就是说你还有一个 agent 那个 API 叫 kill， 然后你可以把这个container kill 掉。然后为什么就这里着重讲一下为什么我们要支持多层 level 的 nesting， 然后其实其中有一个 use case 其实是为了支持 debugging， 也就是说我们把 debugging container 看成一个另外一种 nested container， 只是在那个你要 debug 的 container 的下面。就比如说在这个场景下一个 operator 就是一个运维者说我要 debug nginx 这个 nested container， 然后他可以做的事情是他用同样的一个 API 去 launch 一个 nested container 在那个 nginx 那个 container 下面，然后那个 debug container 可以装自己的那些工具，比如说 GDB 什么的，然后去debug 那个 nginx container， 然后那个容器的销毁跟创建过程跟其他 nested container 是没有任何区别的，所以说这也简化了那个整个代码。然后其实那个 nested container 那个它的语义是这样，其实我们没有说我们指定了某种语义，其实它的语义是被那个 isolator 所定义的。就比如说如果你的 isolator 是你自己写的一个 isolator， 你也可以做你自己的拓展，就是说就比如说 nested container 是不是共享一个命名空间，是不是共享 C group， 这些都是由 isolator 来决定的。只不过我们现在那些default 那些 isolator 做的那件事情是所有的 network namespace and UTS namespace 是共享的，然后 mount namespace 不是共享，因为你想每个pod 里面的 container 它有不同的docker镜像，然后 C group 现在也是共享，但是 C group 我们的 plan 是马上加一个，就是可以不共享，使得 container 在一个 pod container 之间，它的那个 resource 是可以做隔离的。然后为了这个，我们还加了另外一个default executor 来取代原来那个 command executor， 因为原来那个 command executor 只能处理单个task， 然后 default executor 是可以处理 task group。然后它用了最新的 V1 HTTP API， 所以说如果你没有用 V1 的话，你也可以考虑用 V1， 应该是相当稳定了。然后我们的 plan 就是最后 eventually 把那个 command execute retire 掉。然后最后就是说它那个 default execute 现在那个restart policy 是这样，就是说当任何一个 pod 里面任何一个容器结束的时候，它的状态不是零的时候，它会杀掉整个 pod， 就是现在是一个非常简单的重启的一个策略。但是以后我们可以做更多重启的策略，然后 framework 可以告诉那个 executor 你的重启策略是什么，然后executor 会implement 那个重启的策略。然后最后我想做一个 demo， 然后去 demo 这个nested container 跟 task group 的功能。然后我用的是一个我这边起了一个，在我那个虚拟机上起了一个Vagrant box， 然后上面装了那个DCOS， 然后我用 DCOS 做个 demo， 然后我现在先 create 一个service， 用马拉松 create 一个 service， 然后我直接切换到那个 JSON mode 就比较简单一点，我把那个JSON 可以 copy 一下，然后这个 task 其实做的一件事情很简单，它的名字叫 producer consumer， 然后它其实那个 pod 里面有两个 container， 一个是 producer， 一个是 consumer。 然后 producer 做的事情其实非常简单，就是说它有一个 share volume， 就是说 producer 和 consumer 它共享一个卷，然后那个 producer 就是在那个卷里面不断的写文件，然后那个文件名就是当前的时间，然后每一秒钟写一个文件， 然后 consumer 做的事情就是不断的去啊看那个共享的卷里面的文件，然后我们待会儿看一下 output 是，然后想要指出的是这两个 container 用的 docker image 是不一样的，一个是用了 alpine， 一个是用了 busy box， 然后啊这些都是没有 docker daemon 的，就是说所有都是通过 unified containerizer 的 docker 定向，然后我这边看一下 deploy。然后你们可以看到这个 UI 这边这个起了，但是我前面设成 instance 是一，所以我把它 scale 到一。然后你可以看到这个整个 pod 已经起了。如果你点一下这个 task， 你可以看到 producer 跟 consumer， 就相当于这是一个 pod， 然后这是 pod 里面的 container。然后你可以点到每个那个container 去看它那些状态。然后其实你还可以到那个 Mesos 的 UI 去看一看这件事情。如果你去 Mesos UI 看的话，然后你可以看到一个 consumer 一个 producer 都在那边启动的，然后你可以去那个sandbox 里面看里面的状态，就我们先进到 consumer 里面去看那个它输出的点，然后你可以看到那个 consumer 不断在打出那个共享卷里面的文件，然后里面都是当前的时间，然后这是一个 demo， 就演示了怎么去共享卷，这是为什么人们要用 pod 的一个原因。然后还有一个 demo 是我创建一个网络跟网络相关的，它叫 client server。然后这个也非常简单，就是一个 server 一个 client 在一个 pod 里面，然后他们通过 local host 进行通讯。然后 server 做的事情就是他用 NC 起一个 server， 然后每当有个 connection 的时候，他就会 print 一个 Mesos con Asia 返回给那个 client。用的是 busy box 那个 docker container， 然后 client 的话就非常简单，就是不断的去通过 local host 通讯，然后contact 那个 server， 然后也用的是 busy box， 这些都是通过 unified container 起的那个 docker container。然后还有一个就比较有意思，就是说这个东西也是有 IP per container， 用的是 DCOS 里面那个 overlay solution， 就是说你可以把你的 container 起在某个 overlay 去拿到 IP per container， 然后这是一个 name DCOS， 然后我把这个先起来。Always scale 到一。然后你看到那个 pod 也起来了，然后有 client server 也起来，然后你其实可以到 Mesos UI 再去看一眼，就是 client server。如果你点到那个client 的时候，然后去看一下 std out， 你会发现它一直在打印 Mesos con Asia， 也就是说他们网络之间是通过 local host 可以互相通讯的。差不多这就是我那个简单一个 demo， 谢谢大家。
That's all we had. If you have any questions, you can chat with us after the talk, or you can ask questions from. Do we have time for questions? No. So let's talk in the hallway for any questions. Cool. Thanks, guys.